on film? So holistic management, I mean, the basis of it is it's a decision-making framework. And so it's realizing that the decisions you make, not only so, you know, do, trying to think of a good way. So the whole that I'm involved with is the Durham Ranch. Well, inside the Durham Ranch, you know, we've got the Bison Enterprise, obviously, but we also want to improve our range management and the wildlife. We want to improve the habitat for the wildlife. And so it's realizing that the decisions I make not only affect this little hole, but they keep affecting the bigger holes. So, you know, a decision I might make on the bison might improve or decline some deer habitat. It might make, you know, on the people side, there's been things that we've looked at and put through the testing criteria that holistic management has, and it might look really great financially, but it's going to really stress things on the people side, and the people side is really important to us, and so we've decided not to make the decision in that direction. And you know, it's okay, so not only we're the Durham Ranch and we raise bison and that, but we're also a member of the Wright community, so decisions we make, how that affects the community. As a whole, we're very active in the bison industry. John is a past Bison Association, National Bison Association president. John's dad's been a National Bison Association president. They're still active on boards and stuff. And so, you know, it's just recognizing that the decisions we make have that ripple effect as they go out into the larger world. And we test how, you know, maybe a decision looks great financially, but ecologically it's terrible. And so kind of the new catchphrase, you know, does it pass the triple bottom line and things like that. And so, but yeah, it's that decision-making framework. Now, one thing that gets thrown in a lot with holistic management is the grazing management and how we graze. And so that's different for where you're at and how, you know, the animals you're using, your goals for where we're at. Our goal with grazing through the growing season is that a plant only gets bitten one time before it has a chance to fully recover. So for the most, well, not for the most part, unless I have to for moving purposes or the animals for some reason break out, I'll only be through a pasture one time during the grazing growing season, and then I won't be back for, I think pastures average about 270 days of rest before they get grazed again. So there's a lot of planning involved with the grazing program, and so it's more intensive on some places. There's other places that practice holistic management, you know, huge ranches in Nevada and stuff where they, you know, they don't have the infrastructure and so you might be there longer, but you're doing things a little bit differently to try to, you know, change how that grazing occurs. And so, yeah, but the biggest thing is it's just that decision-making framework to make sure, you know, everything's happy. Because, you know, if you're not profitable, the business isn't, you know, sustainable, but if the people aren't happy, the business isn't sustainable either. And so if you're declining ecologically, you're not sustainable. And so it addresses how you make decisions on all, you know, financially, the people side, the ecological side, the community side. So yeah.
Pat's been real integral in not only helping to design our new system that we talked about, the handling system that we remodeled, but also overseeing all the construction. And that was a couple of years ago. And then last year, he took on the design and overseeing the construction of these new feed pens that we built. And big projects. I mean, these have been big projects, bigger than, you know, ones that we've done in many years here. So Yeah, we've kept him pretty busy and focused on that sort of thing. But these are ideas that either Pat's come up with, we have as a team, you know, and we flesh it out as a group, management, owners, you know, the team, the staff, and does this make sense and why? You know, doesn't matter who came up with the idea. And then if it looks good, we run with it.
We do range monitoring. So we've got 27 different transects across the ranch. We monitor half of them every year, so they get hit every 2 years. We've got a range consultant that works with us and comes in and does our range monitoring, to where we'll go in and off those transects. You know, we run a tape line. We've got a grid that we put down at the same place, and so we can monitor our plant species that are coming up, grasses, forbs, brushes. We monitor what our basal cover is. We monitor how much bare ground we have. And so we've gotten measurable results with if what we're doing is improving or declining something, and if there's areas we maybe need to hit differently, or if there's areas that are getting to where we're going, or there's areas that stuff might be coming up that, boy, it's like, why is this happening? Like switchgrass introduced itself in some pastures, and it's happened in pastures, and it's like, why is it coming up here, and where did it come from? And so some of this stuff is kind of like Field of Dreams. If you build it, they will come. I mean, the seed bank is in the soil and is waiting for the right conditions to express itself. And so we're just trying to get to where the right conditions are there. So.
Yeah. How long have you been doing the transect inventories?
85, I think. We can show you in the office. We've got two notebooks of pictures. I mean, they're that deep, that tall. I mean, so I'll show you them in the office. It's pretty fun to go back through things, and you can see the pictures, how things have improved, but see them through the drought and stuff like that. And so it's cool to see. And it's usable. And I mean, you can record all the data you want to, but it's just data until you start to actually analyze it and use it and make decisions off of it. And so we actually, you know, we use it and make decisions off of it. So
historically, we used more or less conventional grazing. We sort of were seasonal grazers. We would graze in the same area every summer and in the same area every winter and such, calving area every year. And then we got introduced to holistic management. We learned about a better way to plan our grazing and utilize the resource, the land base. And with holistic management comes a grazing system, if you will, with a plan and a format, sheets, that paper, you know, format that you use. And it's cumbersome, but it's what we use for several years. And then as time has gone on, with better software being developed, Pat is really good about staying up on what's out there. And he discovered a new program here recently that looks like it's kind of what we've been looking for a long time. So, talk about it a little bit?
So, it's called Maya Grazing, but it's how we do our grazing planning. That getting the past data put into it is, that's really a pretty small project compared to what we've been doing. And that's kind of what I do. I mean, the grazing is that's my big baby that I take care of. And so that falls more into a day-to-day operation. And right now in the wintertime, you know, the herd stays in one space mostly for longer periods of time than in the summer, and we don't have as many irons in the fire, and so I get a lot more time to sit down and crunch data through the winter. I don't have crews, off ranch crews that we're hiring that I'm dealing with managing and stuff like that. And so getting that data entered and developed, is it becomes a lot easier.
Can you tell me what this software program is going to bring together for you?
Well, it's bringing together all of our past. Well, so we've got grazing history records going back to the mid-80s. So we haven't, you know, right now I'm just doing baby steps. I'm getting everything entered back through 06, and then I'll go another chunk of time after that. But it's going to help us track our forage production to how much rainfall we're getting. It's helping us, you know, track what we've been harvesting off the ground. And so developing that data, that's a step into, okay, you know, we can start to correlate it better than we have been to our monitoring data with what we're seeing monitoring, because it's a lot easier to look back at our history. And it's going to help us maybe forecast a little bit better on how we can carry animals, and is ground, are we stressing this piece of ground too much and not knowing it? Are we not challenging this piece of ground enough to really help it reach its full potential? Decisions like that. And so, you know, on a small scale, we've done that and it's been in front of us, but it's hasn't been as readily accessible as it, but it's going to be once we get everything entered.
I think this is more fine-tuned, yep. And it looks to be a much better predictor,
yep.
of things coming based on actual rainfall historic.
Yeah,
we've kept our own record for many, many years on precipitation, and that data becomes a part of this program that helps predict going forward what to expect.
Yeah,
I mean it's looks really cool.
Yeah,
we're excited
and
about it.
Yeah, pairing the two, Australia is hands down way ahead of the states in their grazing management, and how, I mean, they're getting really scientific on an inch of rain, well, millimeters or centimeters of rain that they receive and how that relates to forage production, and you know, they're ahead of us on that. And so working to get to that point, and granted our environment's a little bit different, but and how they look at moisture and stuff, it's changed things. I mean, I entered 1 year's data this spring and I'm like, holy crap, how did I miss that? You know, looking at the rainfall and how it equated to the forage production. And I knew we were tending towards one direction, but not as bad. I mean, it was just like somebody flipped the light on in a dark room, blaringly obvious in front of me when I looked at it through the way it processed the data. So, yeah, pretty exciting.
Yeah.
We like to share what we've learned. I mean, that's one thing with the bison industry is it's not... It's one big happy family for the most part, and we like, everybody likes to share where they're going, because we're all on board with promoting number one the species, but number two the landscape, the land behind it. And so, you know, when other ranches are experiencing something that they've learned through improving soil health, you know, we want it to get out there. So every, you know, rising tide raises all ships, and that's how we want the industry to be, how we want the landscape to be. I mean, share it with anybody that wants to listen on how we're improving soil health, because that's, you know, huge.
For us, having been in the bison business for over 50 years, there was some early competition because there was a lot less numbers then, right? And there was a few of those pioneers that sort of would lock horns a little bit, but you know, as time has gone on, it's become a very open, like Pat said, a family, more or less. And then once we got introduced to holistic management, that just compounded that, you know, desire of that we have to share our insights, to share our learnings, our mistakes, the things that we've overcome. And so bison business is very open that way.
Yeah. I mean, so we're in two very open. Number one, the bison business is very open. And number two, holistic management is very open. And so
it's a great combination.
Yeah, for sure.